Okay, I hope we're all pumped now. I just want a little bit of walk-on music for today's lecture. We're going to talk about induction. Section 5.2, welcome back. I've finally gotten around to making up a plan for the remainder of the semester in terms of like timing and tentative due dates and whatnot. Don't worry about those too much. I've got those posted on our Moodle site, and I'll send you some information about that by email as well, just so you have some kind of structure for how we might finish out the semester together. Again, don't worry about the due dates too much. Tentatively, I think I've got the homework for sections 5.1, 5.2, and 5.3 due not this Friday, this coming Friday, which is, I realize that you don't have a timestamp on this, so that'll be the 20th. Not next Friday, but the Friday after that. But I'll make sure that all the due dates are clear and whatnot. And again, as I indicated in the revised syllabus that I sent you, I think I sent you all last night, don't sweat the due dates too much. I'm willing to be flexible as long as I know y'all are doing the work. So, we're going to go ahead and talk in this second video about the principle of mathematical induction, which is a really powerful technique I think I mentioned a little bit in the video for section 5.1. That's used for proving properties of the integers or some subset of the integers. Generally speaking, you have a starting point and then subsequent cases after that. So very commonly, for instance, you'd be proving some statement about all natural numbers. So you would want to prove it for n equals 1, n equals 2, n equals 3, and so forth. And as we all know, you can't prove by example. So you can't simply say, well, it's true for 1, 2, and 3, so it's true for all integers. No, you have to prove every single case exhaustively, which you can't do for an infinite set. Or you have to come up with some generalized way of doing it all at once. Now, induction is different from the idea of the generic particular that we've talked about before, because the generic particular, you're essentially taking an arbitrary number, like an arbitrary even number, right? It would be n equals 2k. And you're using some algebra, computation, logic to, from that generic particular, derive some general statement. So induction is going to be a little different. I'll describe the procedure, we'll go through a few examples together, and then I'll give you a little bit of a quiz and some practice problems. So the idea behind induction, I'm going to grab my notes so I make sure I'm using the same notation, consistent with the notation and terminology of your book. There are three steps. There's a basic or basis step. So some people call it the base case. I think your textbook calls it the basis step. And that's essentially your starting point. You're going to prove that it is true. Prove the claim true, or claim or property true, for some initial case. And again, depending on what property you're trying to prove, it could be that the initial case is n equals 1 or n equals 10, wherever it is you're starting with. I think your textbook uses the notation P of A. The property is true of some starting point A or something like that. Your next step is to, this is the really easy step, this is just assume the property or claim for some fixed value k. And so this would be, essentially what you're doing is you're assuming the property is true, P of K. You're assuming the property is true at that point K. This is called, by the way, the inductive, because you're making an assumption, this is called the inductive hypothesis. You're taking something to be true. You're assuming it's true as an hypothesis. And then finally, the inductive step, you are proving, generally based on the assumption that you just made in the previous step, using some fact about assuming P of K is true to prove that P of K plus 1 is true. This is called the inductive step, because you're stepping because you're stepping from one case to the next, from P of K to P of K plus 1. Now, again, you're assuming P of K is true and using that fact to prove that P of K plus 1 is true. And here's how this works, because it's a little tricky at first to understand induction, because it's different from any of the proof methods we've had before. At first glance, if you're not familiar with induction, it looks almost like you're only proving two things. You're proving a base case, and then you're proving some arbitrary case sitting around in the middle of nowhere. But here's how this will work. Let's say I'm not really interested in a statement being true for all natural numbers, but let's say I'm really interested in its truth for n equals 17. Let's say we're trying to prove that some claim is true, P is true, some property is true, of n equals 17. And I'm going to think of 17 as like a domino sitting here, off in the middle of nowhere. But there's a lot of dominoes leading up to. There are a lot of dominoes leading up to P equals 17. In particular, let's just say, I'm using dominoes as an example because this is how we might want to think of this, almost like a chain reaction. Let's say that I've got this first domino over here. The first domino, n equals 1. Now, the base case is essentially corresponding to saying, well, let's say I know, I can prove that I can flick that first domino over, that the first domino will fall, n equals 1 will be true. So the claim being true is kind of like that corresponding domino being knocked over. The base case is essentially saying, well, let's prove that we can knock over the first domino. All right, so the base case allows us to knock that first domino over, and what we'd really like is that in that domino's falling, it starts a chain reaction. And that's exactly what the inductive hypothesis and the inductive step together are doing. Because based on the first one falling, if we can prove that whenever the kth domino falls and the k plus first domino falls, we can get something going. Because going from assuming the first domino, let's take k equals 1 for instance, going from assuming the first domino falls, if we've proven the inductive step, if we've proven that P of K plus 1 is true whenever P of K is true, well, if K equals 1, we just showed in the base case that when K equals 1, we can knock that domino over. So applying the inductive step says, taking K equals 1, that shows that P of 1 plus 1 or P of 2 must be true. In other words, because we've proven the base case and we've proven the inductive step, this means that the second domino will have fallen because the first domino will have landed into it. And now the second domino falls. But guess what? Because we've proven the inductive step, knowing that the second domino, the K equals 2 domino, has fallen, allows us to conclude that the third, or the 2 plus first domino, will have fallen. So that enables us to knock over, using the second domino, to knock over the third domino, and so forth. So we get this chain reaction going. Looking at it from the other end, thinking about 17, thinking about K plus 1 equals 17, that domino will have fallen if we can prove that the 16th domino had fallen and knocked it over. Well, the 16th domino will have fallen if we can prove that the 15th domino had fallen to knock it over, and so forth. So we can look at it either way. We can talk about starting from the base case and moving forward, or we can think about the case we're really interested in and working backwards to the base case from it. In any case, no matter how we want to look at this, whichever way makes more sense to you logically, using just the base case to start our chain reaction, and using this kind of this pairing of the inductive hypothesis and the inductive step allows us to get this chain reaction that knocks over all the dominoes. And there's nothing special about 17. I picked that as sort of a concrete reference, but this could be true about any number past 17 as well. as long as it follows our base case. All right, so we're going to look at a couple examples in a moment here. But first, I'm going to make sure I find that cap that I threw away in my excitement. All right, to recap. We have a method now. Now let's see what this looks like. I'm going to do a sort of classic example of induction. And this is the Gaussian identity, named after Carl Friedrich Gauss, probably the greatest mathematician of all time, who, when he was 7 years old, proved the following identity. He did it in a different way. You can look up online and learn more about how Carl Friedrich Gauss, an 18th, 19th century mathematician, was able to come up with a pretty quick formula for the sum of the first n integers when he was 7. There's a story there, but I'll leave it to you to look that up. We're going to use induction to prove this property here, that the sum of the first n integers is equal to this simple formula here, n times n plus 1 over 2, which you've probably seen before if you've taken calculus, because it's used in some pretty basic integral calculus computations. All right, how would we do this? Well, first, recognize that this really is a claim. I can make it explicit. For any natural number n. So I'm making this claim for any natural number n. You can think of this identity as the claim P of n. Again, the property of a number n is that this left-hand side computation gives rise to this formula here. So what we really want to do is, our goal then is to prove P of n is true, that this equation holds for all natural numbers n. And let's just go through this inductive argument here, the three steps. Our base case. In this case, we're claiming that it's true for all natural numbers, so our base case is going to be n equals 1. So we must show P of 1 is true. And sometimes this is just, usually the base case is just some simple direct computation or some direct argument of some kind. In this case, it's no different. So note that the left-hand side of this equation, when n equals 1, is simply 1, right? Because our sum just involves the single term 1. And the right-hand side, if we look at this formula here, plugging in n equals 1, we get 1 times 1 plus 1 over 2. Well, that's 1 times 2 over 2, which is also equal to 1. So the base case holds. Where the base case is true. So that wasn't too hard. And very often the base case will be pretty simple, and usually it's a little easier than the inductive step. The inductive hypothesis, however, is really easy, because all we do, if you recall, is we assume P of K is true for some K. Now, I want to be clear here. When I say some k, this is kind of like our generic particular. So I want to be clear that what I'm really doing is making this a generic particular k. It's fixed. It's a fixed value of k, but it's arbitrary. K could be anything, which is sort of the genericness of this particular choice of k. And now we go to the inductive step. And as I mentioned before, the inductive step is sort of based on the inductive hypothesis. Assuming it's true for some value k, we wish now to prove that it is true for k plus 1. So we must prove P of k plus 1 is true. So to do that, we're going to go back and ask, well, what is P of k plus 1? It's the claim that this side of the formula, when n equals k plus 1, is equal to this side of the formula, when n equals k plus 1. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start with this formula here and try to work it out to make it this formula here, using the fact that we know the inductive hypothesis. hypothesis. Again, assuming the previous domino falls, we want to make sure it knocks over the next one. I should have said earlier when I was looking at this, when I had this picture on the other side of the board that had the dominoes falling, really proving the inductive step is just making sure like there isn't a gap between the kth domino and the k plus first, because if the kth domino falls, that's too far away from the k plus first, it leaves it standing. So really what we're doing when we're proving the inductive step is making sure there's no such gap, that if k falls, then so does k plus 1. All right, so let's look at this k plus 1 here. The left-hand side is going to be 1 plus 2 plus all the way up to k plus 1, right? Because we're trying to prove p of k plus 1 is true, so I'm going to put k plus 1 in for n. And the left-hand side is just the sum of all the numbers up to that value there. But embedded inside of it, notice what we start with here. The first k terms in that sum, adding all the way up to k plus 1, are the first k terms. But we're already assuming something in the inductive hypothesis. We're assuming p of k is true. P of k is the claim that the sum of the first k numbers is going to equal this formula when we plug in k for n. In other words, by the inductive hypothesis, this portion of the sum that I'm interested in is just k times k plus 1 over 2. So, by inductive hypothesis, we want to be clear that that's what we're assuming here. And I'm going to be lazy and just write by induction. This is equal to k times k plus 1 over 2. And now the only term left that isn't involved in this first bit is k plus 1. So I will add k plus 1. And we're almost done here. Now it's just a little bit of algebra. We've got a fraction over here, and we've got a quantity without a fraction. So to add those, I'll just find a common denominator, namely multiply this by 2, and put it all over 2. But now, notice that I've got a k plus 1 term in common here. I can take those k plus 1s and factor that out, and I have k plus 2 multiplied by that. A little bit of basic algebra. Now, we're done. We just don't know it. Well, maybe we know it, but just to make it brutally obvious, what we can do is we can rewrite k plus 2 as k plus 1 plus 1, which makes it really obvious that this is this formula on the right-hand side with n equals k plus 1, because we have n equals k plus 1 and n plus 1 equals k plus 1 plus 1. That's it. This is it. This is the formula we wanted, so I will squeeze in a little tiny end of proof box there, and we're done. We've proven the Gaussian identity. And again, the steps are to prove by induction, and generally speaking, kind of like when you prove something by way of contradiction, we use the BWOC abbreviation to remind the reader, to point out to the reader that we're going to use a contradictory proof. Very often we will say something like, we prove this by induction, or something like that, induction on n even. So we started off proving by induction, and we proved the base case, that it was true for the first value, n equals 1. We made the assumption that it would be true for some fixed but arbitrary k, and using that information, notice we used critically the assumption that we had proven it for p of k. Using that information as a critical step in the inductive step, we prove that it's true for k plus 1. And that is the general structure of an inductive proof. I'm going to go ahead and do one more example, and then I'll give you a little quiz and a couple of practice problems to think about, in addition to the problems that I've assigned, the practice problems already assigned in the homework. So, I hope everyone is staying safe and healthy, and washing your hands frequently with soap and water. For extra credit on the quiz, I will give you, maybe not on the quiz, as an extra credit assignment, go ahead and submit a video to me of your hand washing song. I've heard everything from the classic Happy Birthday Twice to the first verse of Prince's Little Red Corvette. But if you have a favorite hand washing song, maybe one of your own inventions, please submit it, and I promise I will not share it with the rest of the class unless I find it exceedingly humorous to do so. Okay. Let's switch colors up. Let's see. I don't think that one's working. I'm sticking with blue and black because I think those are more visible on the screen here. Well, that one's boring. Let's do this one. I've got a few examples in my notes here. So let's prove. Yeah, I said I changed colors, but it's blue again. Curse me and my refilling at random. Prove that if n is greater than or equal to 4, then 2 to the n is less than or equal to n factorial. Remember n factorial, as we talked about a couple times now, including in the last video, was the number you get if you multiply n by n minus 1 and so forth all the way down to 1. So notice our base case is different here. We have a different base case. We have n equals 4. Our claim only starts at n equals 4. It doesn't start earlier than that. So our proof by induction, again, we're just signaling to the reader or the audience that we are going to prove by induction, consists of a base case to begin with. Now I'm being a little sloppy here. If I wanted to be, let me be a little more careful because I do want to make sure I'm staying in complete sentences. We begin with the base case, n equals 4. In this case, the left-hand side equals 2 to the 4th, which is 16. And the right-hand side equals what? 4 factorial, which is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which is 24. And 16 is indeed less than or equal to 24. So the base case is true. The base case holds. Excellent. All right, now do we do the easiest step of the proof? As an induction hypothesis, assume 2 to the k is less than or equal to k factorial for some fixed but arbitrary k. And again, this is our sort of our inductive version of a generic particular. We want to make sure we have a k that's generic. It could stand for anything. But for the purpose of the proof, it is fixed. And now we need to prove the inductive step. We must show p of k plus 1. That is, 2 to the k plus 1 is less than or equal to k plus 1 factorial. But we can do the same thing that we did last time, essentially. We're just going to do a chain of equalities, or in this case, inequalities. We're going to start with 2 to the k plus 1 and do a few computational steps to show that it ends up being less than this factorial. All right. Note, 2 to the k plus 1 equals, the easiest way to work with this and to get it looking like something we might be able to apply our inductive hypothesis to, is to just factor out a 2. And if you factor out a 2, that's like taking away that plus 1 there. Because 2 to the k plus 1 is really saying, take 2 and multiply it by itself k plus 1 times. If I pull 1 2 aside, I still have k 2s being multiplied together. So 2 to the k plus 1 is 2 times 2 to the k. But our inductive hypothesis, right here, our inductive hypothesis says that part alone, that 2 to the k,
is less than or equal to k factorial. Because that's exactly what our inductive hypothesis is saying right here. 2 to the k is less than or equal to k factorial for some fixed but arbitrary k. So let's replace. We can make this bigger, definitely bigger, by replacing 2 to the k with k factorial. But the fact that 2 is definitely less than or equal to k plus 1, we're going to use that fact right here. Because 2 is definitely less than or equal to k plus 1, I can replace that 2 with k plus 1. And why is that? Well, it's because we're only concerned with numbers that are bigger than 4 to begin with. So k is bigger than or equal to 4. So k plus 1 is actually bigger than or equal to 5. It's definitely bigger than 2. All right? So, we get this. Our 2 to k plus 1 is less than or equal to this. But think about it. If I'm taking k factorial and I'm adding, or not adding, I'm multiplying by an additional k plus 1, that's really the same thing as k plus 1 factorial, because the k factorial has every other term in k plus 1 factorial except for that first one. And there it is. We just multiplied it in. So we're done. Again, we have shown through a chain of inequalities that 2 to the k plus 1 is less than or equal to k plus 1 factorial, which is what we wanted to do. And we did it, again, by induction. We established a base case. The first dominant got knocked over. We established the combination of the inductive hypothesis with the inductive step showed that if one domino gets knocked over, so does the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and so forth, until I get knocked off of the screen. So, all of this together shows that this will be true for any n greater than or equal to 4. All right, so I'm going to leave it at that. Give you one more question, one more practice problem to think about on your own, as well as a quiz. I don't remember what quiz we're on now, so I'm going to call it quiz. I'm going to call it CE in the coronavirus era. We're going to call it quiz CE1. So the additional practice problem that I have for you. Yeah, that's an interesting one. Let me give you one involving a sum. Remember the sigma sum notation from our discussion of sequences in the last video. This one also has to do with calculus. Calculus involves geometric series and the sums of geometric series quite frequently. So here's a practice problem. Prove that if n is greater than or equal to 0, so there you go, here's your base case, and r is not equal to 1. R is just some real number here. It doesn't matter what it is. The n is the critical point here. If n is greater than or equal to 0 and r is not equal to 1, then the sum from I equals 0 to n r to the I is this formula. R to the n plus 1 minus 1 over r minus 1. If you don't want to work with the sigma notation, you can always write this as when I equals 0, that's where the sum begins. This is going to be 1 plus r squared plus r cubed, and so forth up to r to the n. If you prefer to not think of it in terms of sums, sigma sum notation, you can always write this out. So again, by induction, prove that this sum gives us this formula when n is bigger than or equal to 0. So your base case is going to be n equals 0, and so forth. And now quiz CE1. And I will have a place on Moodle for you to upload solutions to your quizzes. Quiz CE1 is the following. Just tell me, what are the 3 steps of an inductive proof? You don't have to give an example, you don't have to explain them, just tell me what the 3 steps are. And again, I will have a place in Moodle for you to upload your solutions. So thank you so much. As always, I'm here for you. If you have any questions at any time, let me know. I still haven't set office hours, but if you need to get together with me in Google Hangouts, just shoot me an email, and I'll make myself available. Math Lab Hour should be coming online next week as well, as will, and I'm sure Stephen will have some availability too to help out through supplemental instruction. So thank you so much for your attention. Let me know if you have any questions, and I'll see y'all soon.